This is Eric, the Cocos Evangelist. In the last video, I introduced how to get resources for the game and how to build the scene. Today, I will follow up the last video to talk about how to control the character movement. In the last video, because the resource pack has some problems due to my fault, I had to do some repair operations to get it to work. After I finished recording the last video, I re-uploaded a Cocos Astronaut resource pack. Similarly, switch the language to Chinese, then open the Cocos store. Select art resources. You can easily find the Cocos Astronaut model. Get and download. Delete the previous resource pack. I've already imported the new one. There is a Cocos prefab in the pack. Just drag it into the scene. Adjust its position. In the last lesson, we placed the first cloud, but we haven't decided his step length yet, so we don't know if the model is the right size. Let's first decide his step length. I want him to move 1 unit per step. Select the cloud node. Because I'm using macOS, so I should press Command and D. If you are using Windows, just press Ctrl and D to duplicate a cloud node. Then we offset its x-axis position by 1 unit. Now you can see 2 cloud models. Their position overlap too much. In this case, there's no way to clearly distinguish visually whether there is a step to jump or not, right? So we should delete this duplicate model. Then resize the cloud again to about half its original size. The y-axis is shortened too much. Let me increase it a bit. Okay, now it looks better. Duplicate it. Let's see the effect. Duplicate another. Now we can clearly see 3 clouds, right? 1, 2, 3. Okay. The first platform composed of 3 clouds is done. Next, adjust the position of the character on the y-axis to about 0.5. Okay. Now we can start to control the movement of the character. There's no rush to complete the whole runway first, because we usually do it step by step. It will be easier to debug. Next, let me create a let me switch the language back to English. Create a folder called script, which is used to store the scripts we'll write later. Next, create a script to control the character. Player controller. Double click to open. If you find you can't open the script with the proper tool, you can go to Preferences, find the External Program tab, and associate the script editor you want to use here. Okay, back to the script. Let's take a look at the top part. All engine built-in modules come from the CC module. We can introduce the CC module by import from CC. The default CC module includes a decorator module, a component module, and a node module. The decorator module is mainly responsible for the interaction of components and their properties with the editor and the serialization part. It's okay if you don't understand now. We'll cover that later. Let's take a look at the CC class part first. CC class is actually a decorator, which is mainly used for the engine to store the name of the class. So in which part is it mainly reflected? Let's go back here. Create an empty node called hero. The script is to be attached to the character, and a Cocos prefab is a complete set of model prefab assembled from the original assets, so try not to change this set of configuration. So I created this empty node, and drag the prefab under it to be its child node. Delete its offset on the y-axis, and add an offset of 0.5 to the hero node. Okay, Then drag the script into the inspector panel. Now the script is attached to the hero node. This one is the name of the component. And this represents which asset the current component belongs to. As you can see, it belongs to the TypeScript file we just created. If we change the name defined in CC class, for example, add a C, save, then you'll find the name of the component is changed, right? So the name defined in CC class is the name of the component displayed in the editor. Restore its name. Another commonly used decorator is property, which is mainly used to define properties. We'll talk about this later when we need to define one. It will be easier to understand. Next, let's take a look at how the script is driven by the engine. If you want the engine to drive a script, the script must be a component. That's why the component is imported from CC module by default at the beginning, which is the base class of the component. As long as the script inherits from the component's base class, then the script is a component script. Also, this script must be attached to one of the nodes in the scene. Since it's attached to the hero node, it qualifies. Besides, both the component itself and the node it is on should be active. The node it's on is active. The component itself is active too. Okay, both conditions are met. Therefore, the engine will drive the component to run. But how does the engine do that? The main point is about the life cycle part. Life cycle includes on enable, start, update, late update, on disable, and on destroy. On enable and on disable are called each time a component is enabled and disabled. Start will only be called once after the component is instantiated, and not again after that. It's executed after enable. Update and late update are both functions that will be executed every frame. Update is executed first, late update is executed later. On destroy will be executed when the component is destroyed. And start is the most commonly used one, so by default, a script is created with start. After understanding the life cycle, next let's write the logic for character movement. Because we're gonna make the character move, we need to receive an event response when the event is triggered. Here, I'm listening the mouse up event, so I use system event on to listen. The event listener requires three parameters. The first one is the event type. I use the mouse up event. The second one is the callback of the event. And the third is the target of the callback. I fill in this as the target. Next, complete the callback function. The callback function receives a parameter event. Its type is event mouse. And the event mouse is from CC. Why do I know that it receives a callback parameter and the type of this parameter is event mouse? We can do it like this. Hold down Command in macOS or Control in Windows. Move the mouse to on. Click. You can jump to the declaration of the event listener. The first parameter is type, and the second one is callback. The parameter received by the callback is event mouse, so now we know that this method will receive a callback. The type of the callback parameter is event mouse. When we get the mouse up event, we need to know whether the mouse click is the left button or the right button, because we need to define which button jumps one step or two steps. I define to press the left mouse button to jump one step and the right button to jump two steps. Get the button event by event get button. The return value is a number. 0 represents the left mouse button, 1 for the mouse wheel, and 2 for the right mouse button. After the listener gets the event, we need to define a function to process jump steps. This function receives a parameter to distinguish the steps. It's of type number. When jumping one step, I set it to 1 and 2 for 2 steps. Next, I need to define some parameters. The first one represents after I receive the user's mouse event whether the character starts to jump. The second one is the step length, one step or two steps. The third one is the time of the current jump. The fourth is total time, one step or two steps, we all jump in 0.1 second. The fifth is the speed of the current jump. The sixth is the current position. The next one is the position of the character. After defining these parameters, we will use them to process on the function jump by step. Because we received the message, we set start jump to true, and the number of steps received is step. Next, our current jump speed is divided by the number of steps by the total time. Because the total time remains the same, so we have to make the speed faster, then reset the current time, then get the position of the current character, and get the position of the target we want to jump to in the end. Here we use the vector addition method, current position plus our step length, to get the final position. When we get the data, we can start moving the character. Do you still remember the update method I said about the life cycle? It's called on every frame. So just move all the comments in the method, because the update method is called on every frame. We need to start the jump after receiving the user's mouse click event. So we defined a variable, whether to start jumping. At this time, we need to know if the start jump parameter is true. If it's true, execute the logic. Otherwise, skip the logic. Next, start processing the time. Because update method is called every frame, so we can get the time difference between the two calls, we can use this time difference to calculate the time. Calculate whether the current time is longer than our total time. If it's longer, the current position should be the target position. And at this time, the jump of the character is also over. No need to call the update method anymore. Otherwise, we'll have to process the movement of each frame, right? We need to get the position of this character every frame. Then we need a value to get its movement difference. Define another variable called delta position. Multiply the speed and time to calculate the distance difference of the movement. Next, add delta position to current position and return to current position. Then pass the current position to the character to set its position. After completing these tasks, just click the mouse. The character will move. Let's verify the logic. Click the run button. Looks okay, right? Although our display angle is not right, but the logic's okay. Then we click the right mouse button. Oops, I can't tell if it's right. Let's run it again. Two steps, right? Two steps, two steps, two steps. Seems right. Next, let's add some protection measures to the logic. Because when the character is jumping and has not finished, our mouse can keep clicking. If we click frequently, it may cause multiple responses and multiple calls. So we add a protection logic here. A parameter called isMoving. Let's suppose the click event has been received at this moment, but the jump is not over yet, just return. Add a function at the end to tell that the jump is over. After the jump, set the parameter isMoving so that it can receive mouse click events again. Okay, the protection is done. Let's run it again. The performance here is not very obvious, But we must be rigorous when writing the code logic, right? Okay, that's all for today. In the next video, I'll talk about how to animate the character and how to upgrade the runway. See you in the next video.